Nicholas Wapshott is currently the international editor for Newsweek, and he has previously held senior editorial positions at such distinguished outlets as the London Times, the Observer, the New York Sun, and Daily Beast. And he has worked for a remarkable collection of figures in the publishing world, ranging from Oprah Winfrey to Rupert Murdoch. but because he signed various non-disclosure forms, he can't talk about any of that. He is as well the author of multiple biographies, ranging from celebrities such as Peter O'Toole to intellectuals and political leaders. Notable among these books are Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher, A Political Marriage, and Keynes-Hayek, The Clash That Defined Modern Economics. One reviewer praised the author of that book for using his lucid skills as a journalist to make someone like Hayek accessible to a general audience, which is, I think, no small thing. These skills are on display in the book that we'll be discussing this evening, The Sphinx. And I just want to say that by way of background, as some of you perhaps have been attending these programs, we've done quite a number of book programs in the past year on Franklin, Roosevelt, and the early period of World War II. We had Michael Fullove here talking about this period. Nigel Hamilton was here. So this marks then my third opportunity to talk to an author who's gotten into this period. And having written about this myself in a longer book on wartime presidential leadership, I must say I still find it endlessly fascinating and learn a great deal from each one of these authors, even though the ground they cover is one that's fairly familiar to those of us who've studied the period. Every historical book is written in its own historical context. What led you to write The Sphinx at this particular time?
Well, it's always a good idea if you can try to make history seem a bit contemporary. And certainly the previous book that I wrote, which was about Keynes and Hayek, coincided with what turned out to be a national debate about whether we should borrow money in order to get out of the profound economic depression that we'd slipped in 2008-09. Or whether you should pay down the debt as fast as possible. So it completely suited the public mood, which was very good for book sales, I must say. And an author, you do need that. In this case, I was two things that I think encouraged me. One was that I got the sense that there was, and it was a sort of follow-on from the Hayekians, really, a feeling that there were people who actually would prefer to draw back American horns to stay behind the oceans as the isolationists did. Ron Paul was the only open isolationist, I think. Now you can tell an isolationist usually by the way that they preface everything by saying, I am not an isolationist. That's a sure sign they probably are. They are against foreign aid and they are against military spending. They want to cut military spending drastically. And the implication of that, if you go into it, means that they're going to withdraw American influence from around the world. And so I wasn't anxious about that, but it was a movement in the political sphere that I was interested in following. And then the other thing was just a personal thing. It's purely to do with my age. I grew up in the immediate post-war period in Britain, as you may hear from my accent. And we were very interested always in the way the war turned out. We went into the war a great mighty British empire, and we came out of it totally bust. Living in austerity for 6 years, went on longer. Rationing went on for 8 years, I think, after the war. And so the question that most British people wanted to know is, to Franklin Roosevelt, were you to be around, which is, what took you so long? You know, this was, as we know, a good war. This was a moral war. And yet America, you know, it was late in World War I, that's excusable. But in a war against Hitler and fascism, to be nearly 3 years late, and allowing Britain to go bust is a question worth explaining. And so there was a sort of a residual, there's a part of the Brit in me which would like to explain to British people why it wasn't quite as easy as you might wish for Franklin Roosevelt merely to, you know, turn the switch and declare war. In fact, he's not capable as a president of declaring war. And I think that particularly for Brits from a parliamentary tradition where the chief executive, as long as they hold a majority in the House of Commons, can do more or less as they like. That's not the way that the American Constitution has worked. It's here designed specifically to be divided and for no one arm of government to be able to do exactly as it wishes. So That's a very convoluted answer, but that's the full one.
So you tell the story, and you tell it very well in the book, of how Franklin Roosevelt navigated around isolationist and anti-interventionist sentiment in the years before Pearl Harbor to forge an alliance between the United States and Great Britain. Tell us why this was such a formidable challenge for Roosevelt at the time.
Well, it all goes back really to World War I, I suppose. There was always a sense, and this is just to do with technology, there was always a sense in America that really, right from the founding fathers, from Jefferson and Washington, that you could beware foreign entanglements, and America was better off if it didn't get involved with anything abroad, because, you know, the Europeans were a mess and they only caused trouble. So the best thing to do was just live in a single country, and for goodness sake, America had everything that it needed, marvelous raw materials and so on. But when you came to the beginning of about a century ago, the turn of the last century, America by then had reached a head of steam economically, particularly, and was a very rich and powerful country, if it only wished to use that. But it didn't stop a lot of people thinking we're still much better off staying protected by the vast Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean. This is when, even by the 40s, it took four hops to get from Europe to here in an airplane. And so they justifiably could say, it's nothing to do with us. Let's just trade with everybody and let's not judge them and let the Europeans pickle in their own juice. And you get a sense of that today. A number of people will say that. We don't care about the Middle East. Let them just kill each other. You know, that's fine by us. And that sense was very strong. There was also sort of financial reasons. There was enormous indignation in World War I that Britain, that borrowed an enormous amount of money to wage World War I, it was one of those things, then as now, Wall Street wasn't prepared to lend to the French, and in those days the Italians in World War I were on the Allied side. They didn't believe they'd get the money back. They were absolutely right, by the way. The French never did pay the money back. But Britain, being, you know, silly, said, we'll borrow all the money for you. So, and of course, through the 20s and 30s, Britain had not paid back the money. And there was enormous indignation about that. There was indignation, too, in Congress about the sense that maybe World War I was, we joined the war purely to allow people who make munitions to profit. There was a great congressional inquiry into all of this. Anyway, there was an enormous head of steam, particularly people in the Midwest. The people who were benefiting from the New Deal on the whole were also isolationists. So there was a strange trade-off, really, in Franklin Roosevelt's mind, I think. And so even through the 30s, as one horror after the next, after Japan had invaded Manchuria and then China, after the Anschluss, where Germany had just taken over, just marched straight into Austria and then started nibbling at the Sudetenland and then took Czechoslovakia and then threatened Poland and so on. One thing after the next. And the isolationists still said, let's keep it a distance. Mm-hmm. So it was a means of trying to, that's what he was stuck with, a very strong body of, a lot of them inherited, the same people actually from the World War I, who were still there 20 years later.
Yes, yes. So there are several characters who figure centrally in the book, besides Roosevelt. The most important is Joseph P. Kennedy. Yeah. Why did you choose him as a protagonist to tell this story?
He's one of the many isolationists. One of the great things about storytelling in this particular period is that the heroes are real heroes. I mean, that is, Franklin Roosevelt and Winston Churchill are amazingly good fun to spend time with. And the villains are really villainous. You know, I mean, Father Coughlin and so on is a pretty terrible person, and Henry Ford, you know, anti-Semite beyond measure, and Walt Disney, and Charles Lindbergh, not nice people. The reason that I particularly concentrated upon Joe Kennedy was that it was one of those things that Franklin Roosevelt knew that he had to do. This is a period where he had to pivot between trying to cure the Depression and then trying to cure fascism. And it turned out, as John Maynard Keynes might have told him, that actually the way to cure the Depression actually was to wage a war on the scale that you would need to in order to fight fascism.
Right.
But this is fall of 37 to Pearl Harbor, December 41, which is the anniversary we've just passed. And in that period, he's doing a pivot, but what he knows, and it becomes absolutely obvious to him by 37, 38, that either he licks Nazism or somebody else has to. And he looks around and he can't see anyone that he thinks is big enough to be able to do this Herculean task. The Republican Party, for the most part, were isolationists, so you can forget them. But he did have a problem because he had to be re-elected for the second time. That is, he had to serve a third term. He had to get over the bump in the road of the November 1940 election. And he had to defy Washington and all the founding fathers who said, we don't want a monarchy, two terms is enough for anyone. And so he avoided it by, rather like Mrs. Clinton today, he just didn't say what his intentions were. And this, of course, helped an enormous amount. First of all, it was the cryptic, that's why it's called the Sphinx, by the way. The press kept being thrown bones of unlikely people like Harry Hopkins. You know, he'd make a good president. He wouldn't have made a good president. He never stood for an elected office in his life. Postmaster General Garner, he's a good guy. Why didn't you throw them? Hopeless, absolutely. None of these people were elected. But it put them off the track. But they wised up to it eventually. And so at the Gridiron Dinner, which is the annual White House Correspondents' Dinner in December of 1939, so the last 11 months before the election, he came into the ballroom to find that there was an 8-foot-long, 6-foot-high, papier-mâché, golden-painted sphinx with his face on it, with a cigarette holder and his pince-nez and this broad grin. And he laughed his head off. One of the great things about him, spending time with him as an author, is that you chuckle every day if you spend time with Franklin Roosevelt. And he said, I'm having that for my library, which was just being built in Hyde Park. And I don't know whether any of you have been up to Hyde Park recently, but they've revamped it. So if you think you know it, go and see it again, and you'll see the Sphinx. It's there in a glass case for everyone to see. But this cryptic thing about not expressing himself, I mean, you can imagine poor Joe Biden, if he wanted to raise some money today, I'm not going to give you $1,000. Why should I waste any money until Mrs. Clinton's decided? You know, it's a foregone conclusion. So that's what he did. He had to get over this bump.
So,
and he this choked off everybody who needed to raise money, but it didn't choke off Joe Kennedy, because Joe Kennedy could afford to launch his own campaign, and he was in a very pole position. First of all, he was himself an isolationist. He was a businessman, really, a non-interventionist, you could call him. But I mean, as far as he was concerned, we can do business with anybody, really. So that's fine. And even if they're a bit dirty around the edges, that's none of my business. He had no moral dimensions. Not didn't have the moral dimension that, I'm trying to be polite about this, but that's what he felt. And so he could fund his own campaign, and he was hoping against hope that Franklin Roosevelt would eventually say, as he kept saying in public, by the way, and his mother kept saying, and Eleanor kept saying, oh, he's too weary, he's worn out, he could do with a rest, he's looking forward to going, putting his stamp collection in order in Hyde Park, and all these things that they kept saying. And the final piece that Joe Kennedy thought he had everything. He'd set himself up, he'd been the head of the SEC, the poacher turned gamekeeper, he'd ruled Wall Street, and he looked after the Maritime Commission. He thought he'd earned his keep there. He took an amazing French chateau in Maryland, where every weekend he used to have congressmen out in order to, get to know them and showered them with lots of booze and lots of showgirls. He was a great Hollywood figure, if you remember. And so he thought that he had everything done, but he didn't have any foreign policy experience. And so he thought, when the ambassador to London came home suffering from cancer and wasn't expected to return, he thought, oh, that would be good. I could go to London for 6 months, get a bit of foreign policy experience, then I got the full hand. And then if Franklin wobbles, I can stand in and say I'm the ideal person. He also paid a lot of money, hard money, with public relations people, putting this idea about that he was the coming man, any minute.
Let's go in for a moment, though, at the relationship between these two men, because there's a peculiar psychodynamic at work here. Roosevelt literally humiliates Kennedy. As you describe in the book, there's a scene that you describe where it really sounds like you're reading a book about Lyndon Johnson and the Absolutely. Way he treated some people.
Yeah. Yeah, but the relationship between the two of them was very tricky, put it mildly, because Roosevelt knew that Kennedy was sort of breathing down his neck and coveted his job. So he never wanted to give him anything too big to do. At the same time, he quite enjoyed, by the way, going out to those parties at Marland, his house. Franklin Roosevelt was always up for a martini or several. And they were sort of fake best friends. I think that if you were a teenage girl, you'd call them frenemies today. They were neither one thing or the other. And so he loved to humiliate Joe Kennedy at every turn. So he got wind of the fact, because his son James had told him, that Joe Kennedy wanted to be the ambassador to London. And so he, first of all, he said no. Why actually provide him with a foreign policy experience that he needs? That's madness. And he thought about it a little more, and he was a great brooder. He would take a little while, rather like today's president, you know. He liked to think about things before he made any decision. And he came back saying, I think it's a fine idea, we ought to send him. So he called for Joe Kennedy, and James Roosevelt came too, in the Oval Office, and he said, Joe, I'm thinking about it, seriously, but could you just drop your pants for a minute? And Joe Kennedy says, what? He said, you need to drop your pants, please. So he dropped his pants. Can you imagine the scene? It's out of a movie. And he said, James Roosevelt gave us this account, otherwise no one would believe it. And he said, well, there you are. I knew that this was the truth. The fact is that if you're going to be an ambassador to the court of St. James's, you've got to wear knee breeches and tights, and you've got knobbly knees, and you're just going to humiliate the whole of the United States. And he said, you're kidding. And he said, no. And he really did not know whether Franklin Roosevelt was just joshing with him or humiliating. Actually, of course, all of these things, all of the above. And finally, he was allowed to pull his pants up, and eventually he was allowed to go to London. But the great trick about London was that, and this is why he knew that it was a good idea, once having dispatched Kennedy to London, then he became a government employee, which meant that he couldn't resign when he wanted to. And so he just left him swinging in London as things got worse and worse, and his family had to come home because of the Blitz, and Joe Kennedy was just left there in war-torn London. Everybody hated him because he mixed with the Cliveden set, you know, he cozied up to the appeasers and the pro-Nazis, and so altogether he was humiliated more than once in that sense.
It makes a lot of political sense that Roosevelt would send Kennedy and thwart his political ambitions, keep him out of the way, but it was also very risky. That was one of the most, if not the most important, diplomatic positions in the United States, and in no sense was Kennedy aligned with Roosevelt in his view of foreign policy. Did Roosevelt, for his own political reasons, put at risk American foreign policy by putting Kennedy there or keeping him there too long?
Well, I guess it turned out all right, so I guess he got it in the long run, he was right. But no, it's true that there was a risk involved in it. On the other hand, as you know, ambassadors are not necessarily ambassadors as they are for other countries. American ambassadors are very often the guys who do the lavish entertaining and pay the bills, which of course Kennedy could afford, and he liked to do it, and he took his family, and they were great celebrities in pre-war London, and he had a fine old time, really. On the other hand, Roosevelt never trusted him, never gave him any secrets, kept reprimanding him. The Secretary of State, Cordell Hull, kept sending missives saying, you may not say this, I need to see every speech that you give before you give it, then he'd strike things out, then he'd say, and the President thinks so too, so don't try to appeal above my head. And so he was kept on a very short leash. And then, of course, come 1940, the ultimate back channel, as soon as Churchill was in the government as the Naval Secretary, so Franklin Roosevelt opened up then a direct line. He ignored Chamberlain and he ignored Joe Kennedy, and he started writing specifically only to Churchill, and the two of them effectively planned what would happen as soon as Chamberlain was gone.
1938 was a pivotal year in the story. It's the year of the Anschluss, it's the Munich crisis, and FDR encourages the British and the French to stand firm, but he seems to have no impact. Why?
Well, he wasn't equipped with anything to offer the Allies. He actually even couldn't provide them with the war material that they needed. A whole succession of neutrality acts had been passed, and the Johnson Act, which said that you may not sell arms to people who owe you money, which meant everybody on the Allied side. They still hadn't paid back the money from World War I. Neutrality acts which said you may not provide arms for people involved in wars overseas. Eventually, they managed to bend that a little bit with so-called cash and carry. That is, we will send you arms, but you've got to come and collect it. And if they get sunk a couple of miles off the coast, that's up to you. So it's at your risk. But he couldn't really provide. And until Britain was absolutely bust and could show it was bust, he couldn't really help them. And I must say that the speed with which we're talking about something new here, warfare, there's, you know, the Blitzkrieg. It shortened for the Blitz when it was to do with Allied airstrikes on London, but the original Blitzkrieg is a really new means of fast-moving, armored, mobile warfare. And the speed with which Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, France collapsed in front of the Wehrmacht meant that actually there was precious little. It went so fast. There was a time when Churchill would try to keep in touch with the French prime minister. And every day, the cabinet had moved to another provincial French city further away from the action as it moved further and further towards Spain. It was like trying to prevent a snowman from melting in the spring. I mean, it was fast. Only the Channel saved Britain.
We'll come to the war in a moment, but there's one figure we haven't really talked about who I think matters here in your story. Neville Chamberlain realizes Roosevelt doesn't have anything to offer. He feels essentially weak and thinks Britain is weak. One of the reasons he thinks Britain is so weak is because of Charles Lindbergh. So let's bring Lindbergh into this story and talk about his role as an advocate of appeasement and worse, and in particular the role he played in, let's just for want of a better term, frightening people, including the British.
Absolutely. Yeah, Charles Lindbergh's a very interesting case. He's the Kim Kardashian of the story, really, in as much as he was a good engineer, I think. I mean, he could fiddle around with an engine, and he was courageous or mad, I'm not quite sure which allowed him to fly over the Atlantic. And that was his singular achievement in life, really. And on the basis of that, he became an overnight celebrity, welcome in all of the grand country houses in Britain, including Cliveden, where the Astors presided over a mixture of appeasers and pro-Nazis, including Nazis, including Ribbentrop, the ambassador, who they'd have to lavish house parties at the weekend. And Lindbergh chased away from New Jersey, where, if you remember, the horrible events in the kidnapping, then murder of his baby child, he took refuge in Britain and lived in the countryside. He rented Harold Nicholson's cottage on Harold Nicholson's estate, and he set up there, and he was left alone for the most part. He was left alone. But it meant that he was also in a place where he was such a celebrity that he was invited to go and look at new aeroplanes. And he was a sucker for those invitations. And when the Germans said, why don't you come and see our new Messerschmitts and so on, he would go off and see them. Now, he did a sort of odd deal, which is he checked with the US Embassy and said, look, I can find out some stuff for you. On the other hand, he wasn't so smart as to work out that when he went to one place after the next, that very often Hitler was flying the same planes to the next airport, airfield. And so he got a completely inflated idea. And he would sit with cabinet ministers in Cliveden over dinner. They'd be frightened to death as he'd say, well, there's no chance that you'll win against Hitler because he's got thousands of airplanes and they're faster than anything you've got. Britain was very slow to rearm. It couldn't afford it, actually, but it was very slow to rearm during the late 30s. And so he actually did Hitler's bidding in that sense. The other thing was that, I mean, he did have crazy views. He had, off-the-wall views about human nature and so on. If one of the great things about Franklin Roosevelt is that no American can be respectable and be an isolationist today. At the same time, the whole notion of race theory, that somehow that people are different purely because of their religion or color of skin or something, has been totally discredited, and no one in their right mind. I mean, I don't want to distract, but think of poor Jim Watson, for instance. You know, discovered DNA and made this one error of saying a thing about maybe, you know, certain groups of people may have less IQ. That was the end of him, totally written out. And Franklin Roosevelt, I think, has ensured that climate exists here. It's not respectable to be racist. But Charles Lindbergh had those views in spades. He thought that the blonder hair you had, the bluer the eyes you had, this is literal stuff, the more suited you were to, you know, rule the world, and the darker skinned and so on, the less appropriate it was. And so he believed all that stuff, and it was vile and disgusting, but it was amazingly prevalent among a certain group of people that, alas, were at the top of British society at that stage.
You spoke a little bit about the beginning of the war. Let's talk about the United States at the beginning of World War II. When the war begins in September 1939 in Europe, how does Roosevelt respond as president of the United States?
Well, he tries to be as encouraging as he can to the people who are going to... He wants to keep the war over there, and right. He genuinely... I mean, I know that he's duplicitous. I mean, to his great credit, I would say. I mean, sometimes politicians have to say and do different things. But he genuinely believed that Nazism had to be stopped. At the same time, until he was safely in the White House, which was going to be another 15 months, that's even if he got elected, then there's not much he could do about it with Congress being the complexion it has. So he gives them enormous encouragement. But as you said, you know, Chamberlain actually wasn't much interested in him. Chamberlain thought of him rather like he thought of Churchill. He thought he was a wide boy, or he was a bit too flashy for his own good. He was. Chamberlain had a very poor view of Americans in general and had no understanding. I don't think he visited the United States at all. He had no understanding about America and its complexities and its sophistication. He didn't understand that. He just assumed that they were sort of unsuited to take world responsibilities and didn't have sympathy for him. So he helped as much as he could, but it wasn't very much. I think that he was pretty impotent, and I think he was embarrassed about that, actually.
And then we get into 1940 and the fall of France, which I would probably say is the most dangerous moment in the story, between the fall of France and the election in November 1940 and perhaps just beyond that. Because the fall of France takes the legs out from under Roosevelt's war policy. There is no frontline nation to stand between the United States and Hitler. The United States will be on the front line and has to make critical decisions at that point. Will it worry about its own defense first and foremost and rebuild its own military, or will it stake everything on a teetering Great Britain? What leads Roosevelt at that point to make the choices he makes, and what role does Joe Kennedy play in that?
Until he got to the safety of a third term, I think that Franklin Roosevelt was in a position where he would rather the Europeans kept the war over on that side of the Atlantic as much as he could, but it didn't stop him from helping as much as possible. When Churchill said, by the way, the key movement, the collapse of France, I think, shocked everybody to the core. I mean, no one assumed that. I mean, if you think of World War I, the Germans and the French went to and fro a very narrow band because they were very equal in might, but the Blitzkrieg and the use of airplanes by Germany was so overwhelming that France collapsed immensely fast, and that shocked everybody to the core. And the combination of the English Channel and what Churchill referred to as the few, the very small number of fighter pilots, mostly in their early 20s, who would just get into a Spitfire or a Hurricane and go up there and shoot down as many Germans and then come back down, refuel, and go straight back up and so on, that's what saved the whole of Western civilization, if you like, from what otherwise would have been, well, a much more complicated movement if Germany or Nazism had taken over, fascism had taken over the whole of Europe. So until that stage, Franklin was sort of left wondering what he could do best. But there were things that he was doing, actually, and he was doing them surreptitiously, and there were historians at the time, like Charles Beard, who actually spotted what he was doing and would write newspaper pieces and then very fast pieces of instant history in order to show that actually the war had really already started as far as the United States was concerned. That is, that he started extending where the border of America was. It wasn't the usual 3-mile border, it then became a 10-mile border. There was one stage where he said, get me out a map at the Atlantic. And they got it out and they pinned it on the side of a board. And he said, oh, well, I think then, and he drew a line between Greenland and the west coast of Africa and said, so everything west of that really is sort of our American sphere of influence, and in which case we ought to patrol that, in which case we ought to ensure we weren't convoying. It was a huge fuss. Congress outlawed convoying because it meant that we were taking part in the war. So he just described it as something else. This was accompanying or associating with convoys, you know. And actually, the very first shot, I can't remember exactly what the date is, but an American destroyer off the coast of Nova Scotia put depth charges down because there was a German submarine there which was menacing a British convoy. And that was really the very first time that it took place, and it was in 1940. It was nowhere near 1941. So when people talk about whether Roosevelt did or did not get us involved in World War II by pretending not to know about Pearl Harbor, the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, and intelligence towards that, the fact was the United States had been at war for maybe 18 months before Pearl Harbor, in one way or another. It had, even by declaring the sort of embargoes on steel and iron and gasoline and so on to Japan, was could be interpreted as an act of war. And so he used his executive action. You know what it's like when you get a president with a Congress that won't do anything they ask, you know? You push that executive action as far as you can. And he was never quite caught. I mean, people complained about it and moaned and groaned, but they didn't actually have the courage of their convictions to actually knock down anything they did, not like they had done in the New Deal.
Throughout this period, when Roosevelt realizes after the fall of France that eventually the United States is going to get into the war, he realizes as well the American people aren't ready for it. They don't agree. And in fact, despite all of these events that happen in 1941 with the world becoming more dangerous, he's having no measurable impact on American public opinion about getting directly involved in the war, which is curious because we credit him with being very influential.
Well, I'm not sure that that's true, you know. The Dr. Gallup of the Gallup polls was alive in those days, and he's left behind a lot of important and interesting data. And in the fall of 1937, 9 out of 10 Americans wanted nothing to do with a war overseas, come what may, in any circumstances. And by the summer of 1941 already, 7 out of 10 Americans were prepared to help Britain even if it meant going to war. Now that is quite a switch in a relatively short time.
Sure, but let's talk about two other polls. June 1940, fall of France. 2 out of 3 Americans, yes, they want to help Great Britain, but 2 out of 3 Americans are not ready to go into the war directly. A week before Pearl Harbor, 2 out of 3 Americans are not ready to enter the war directly. So Roosevelt does occasionally give a speech that will have at least a short-term opinion. What he's doing as president isn't changing public opinion. What he's doing as president, using the powers you describe, is engineering circumstances that will make war much more likely. It's his actions as president that are bound to bring about what he really hopes will happen, which is that the Germans will fire the first shot and give him the excuse he needs to go to war.
I think that he softened them up, by the way. I mean, I'm sure that the great thing about data, you can choose any points to prove what you want, but the fact is that over this critical period, they became more open to the fact that it seemed increasingly likely that they might be called upon to, you know. That's, I think, to do with his extraordinary powers of communication. There's no doubt that there are not many people who can do it. There are not many presidents, alas, who can do it. And I think that the current president, who we all imagined, I think when he was elected, when he could talk to great football stadiums full of people, that he was a great communicator. But actually, he's not very good at one-to-one. When he's on the TV, he's not talking to me. I keep looking over the shoulder when he's talking to. Whereas there are great communicators, Roosevelt and his fireside chats, they're legendary, and they're also wonderful to listen to. They're mostly available on YouTube. You can listen. They are extraordinary, quite stilted, but still amazingly encouraging. And there are people like Bill Clinton who can do it, obviously. And there are people like Ronald Reagan who could do it. But Roosevelt was immensely persuasive. There were people that he could never reach. Roosevelt was hated by a very small but vociferous minority of people. And I keep meeting people who would talk about their parents and how much they detested Franklin Roosevelt and were glad that he was gone and all the rest of it. But it's for all of those, there were several more.
Dangerous as the world was in 1941, the isolationists were still very, very powerful. Mm. And for example, they came within one vote of defeating the reauthorization of the draft that year. Mm. This is 4 months before Pearl Harbor. The draft had been instituted for 1 year and it was about to expire. And even when it was reinstituted, it still contained language that said no American soldier shall serve outside of the Western Hemisphere, which is one of the reasons why Roosevelt drew those lines on the map, making the Western Hemisphere bigger and bigger and bigger until it took 2/3 of the world.
Yeah.
Why were the isolationists then still able to have so much impact, even as people could see the world becoming smaller and the United States being more and more endangered?
I think that, the clue's in the question, in a way. If you think that it is that war is imminent, probably anything you can do possibly to keep out of it is a very good idea. The more sharp it becomes, the more likely it becomes, the more you think, is there any way that we can keep out of this? And if there are people saying, oh yeah, we can keep out of this, all we have to do is not take part, then I think that they sound somewhere between plausible and wishful thinking. It might not be realistic, but that's what they had. No, America First, for instance, the great popular movement, which was an isolationist movement, actually came very late in the day. It was 1940-41 when America First started out. It wasn't a long-standing organization. And it was vociferous. I think there was a sort of, even listening to the war, this was the first radio war, and people were hearing people like Ed Murrow report from London, and it must have been immensely frightening. Never mind Orson Welles and War of the Worlds. Here was a real conflict going on. You think they could be bombing New York. This could be us. And I think that that must have terrified a lot of people, and they put their head in the sand. They tried to ignore what increasingly became very likely to inevitable.
For my last question before we open it up, I want to take you forward in time to later in the war. Roosevelt had been a great admirer of Woodrow Wilson, an internationalist, and he thought Roosevelt had been an advocate of the League of Nations at the time and remained one for quite some time. So as World War II is ending, he wants to avoid having the kind of failure that Wilson had in trying to get the United States to join the League of Nations. Why is Roosevelt so much more successful at integrating the United States permanently into the world order and shaping the world order after an American agenda than Woodrow Wilson was?
First of all, I think that you learned a lot from Woodrow Wilson's failure. He was the assistant secretary to the Navy for Woodrow Wilson, and there's an absolutely pivotal moment. He used to be Franklin Roosevelt's fifth cousin, was Teddy Roosevelt, and he fell under the sway of Teddy, not least when he married Teddy's niece, Teddy Roosevelt he was the father of the bride, as it were, because his brother had gone at the wedding and started off with those wonderful words, "I always think it's a good idea to keep the name in the family, don't you?" And this is in 1918, part of the stitch-up of the faltering marriage of Eleanor and Franklin was a second honeymoon, hastily arranged, to go to see naval positions in Europe, which by then was at peace, but the Treaty of Paris was being discussed. And on the way out on the ship, Teddy Roosevelt died. And so that great influence, which was constantly egging him on to, give up your government position, put on uniform and fight, that's the way you'll get a reputation in this world, young man, and so on, that came from Teddy, was dismissed. And by chance, on the way back, Woodrow Wilson and Edith were going back temporarily to sign some bills before he then resumed and went back to the Treaty of Versailles to preside over it. And they took with them the Charter of the League of Nations. And these, there were really four people and the captain in the captain's cabin for dinner. And they spread out the thing, and it convinced Franklin Roosevelt that there was another way of doing things in the world. And he became inspired with a sort of post-nationalistic view, a world government, if you like. There were things, for instance, Woodrow Wilson, a very noble man, not a very good politician, as it turned out, but he was interested in trying to make life easy for everybody. He said, "I want victory without victors, or peace without victors." And so Franklin Roosevelt's response, when replaying the same sort of problem at the Second World War, was to say, "I don't want anybody to negotiate with. This is unconditional surrender. We will not treat with anybody, because we'll have to have a treaty, and then we'll have to put it before the Senate, and it'll give me all that trouble." So all of the big pieces in the post-war settlement, and we're talking about the United Nations, which was extraordinary, which was just a conference set up in San Francisco. It was a fait accompli that it would be built, and that was that. There were also the great economic changes. The World Bank was set up, a suggestion of John Maynard Keynes, the Bretton Woods Agreement of currency regulation so that nobody like Weimar should sort of slip off the map. All of that was set up without any consultation with Congress at all. And I guess that's executive action par excellence. That's how to do it. It's, you know, if nobody asks you, then you think you'll just get away with it. You run as fast as you can.
Roosevelt was also clever because he brought some of the congressional opposition into the planning for some of these things, like for the United Nations, he took one of the...
That too was a lesson learned from Woodrow Wilson. Right. Woodrow Wilson wouldn't take anybody over to the Treaty of Paris. He should have taken some Republicans with him. He should have flattered them. You know, there were a lot of guys who would have been suckers for being allowed to sit on or walk around the world stage, particularly at a time when Americans in Paris were greeted as peacemaking heroes, you know, and he failed to do that. Roosevelt was a much cannier politician all the way around, and his main weapon in his armory, if you like, was his ability to flatter and to charm and to win over people who were really his sworn enemies, including people like Joe Kennedy, who repeatedly tried to resign. And he would go into the Oval Office determined this time to resign, and he would come out, you know, convinced of something else, but forgotten all about having to resign. And that's one of the joys, as I say, one of the joys of spending so much time with Franklin Roosevelt, even posthumously, is you have this wonderfully feline, slippery character who worked, on the whole, towards good, which is...
Remarkable as is, sometimes, even today, presidents don't realize it's a good idea to sit down and have dinner with the opposition. Okay, let's open up for some questions. Now, let me just give you a couple of questions, a couple of ground rules here. Wait for the microphone to come to you. Tell us who you are, and please keep your questions brief. No fireside chats or Churchillian speeches. Thank you. Here.
Good evening. My name is Steve Gutman. Thank you very much, sir. With regard to Philip Roth's fiction about Lindbergh. Some aspects of reality and whether there was ever really a chance that Lindbergh could have rallied political support in 1940.
That he had absolutely no political charisma at all. He was constantly being encouraged by the isolationists to sit as the chairman or the president or whatever position you want, and he would never do it. He was just not clubbable. It was just an essential aspect of his character. He was always a lone wolf, you know. That's why he was happy to fly across the Atlantic on his own. To be on his own was when he was happiest. He was never good, he could never glad hand, he could never do any of the things that Roosevelt found so easy to do. So Philip, with a wonderful book, sort of implausible. Much more interesting in a way if Philip Roth had made Joe Kennedy the president. And then I'd like to read that book.
But I just wanted, but one of the things we haven't said about Joe Kennedy and that probably that may have been a real limitation on his political career. He was a Catholic, and Al Smith had recently, as a Democrat, run as a Catholic and had been demolished in an election, and there were real serious questions about whether or not at that point the United States was prepared to elect a Catholic.
Absolutely, even 20 years later, it was an issue for Jack Kennedy too. But Joe Kennedy, he wrote, thank goodness, wonderful long letters and wonderful diaries, including a diary which was never published, which has all now come into the public domain, so you can actually read what he was thinking day by day, week by week. And he's also had all those children he spent his whole time writing to and letting slip his ambitions and so on. And he actually expresses very clearly at one point, I think it's too early for a Catholic president, but in these circumstances, when we're actually looking over the precipice, getting involved in another world war, and you know, hundreds of thousands of American men losing their lives, maybe in those circumstances, they'll see reason. They'll back a Democrat, but they'll back an isolationist Democrat. So it was nip and tuck.
In the back.
I'm Charlie Porter. Regarding the isolationists, apart from the message by Churchill to FDR, probably in connection with the destroyers, the letter, Halifax to Lothian, the suggestion that if the United States lost the protection of the British Navy and no longer was able to shelter behind it, or the concern or thought that if the Germans got a foothold in South America, they might conceivably move north. Were the isolationists confronted with this? Did they have to knock it down?
I think they were aware of it, but it was never argued quite as clearly as you put it, Charlie, and I thank you for expressing that clearly, because it's you're absolutely right. It would be relatively straightforward, even though you couldn't fly a bomber plane from, say, Lisbon to New York, you could in several hops do it. The deal always was, and this is part of to do with the Pax Britannica turning into the Pax Americana, as long as the Pax Britannica was there in the world, and you know half of the nation of the globe was painted pink as part of the British Empire, part of the deal was that they had an enormous navy, and it did just look after the safety of the Atlantic. And so all American trade always benefited from the British taxpayers' ability to protect their ships. That was well known, but it did not become an issue. South America, everybody was very anxious about that, as we know. In the post-war period, it became actually a haven for Nazis on the run. There's something about some of their societies down there which make that sort of thing very welcome. Interestingly, one of the ways that Roosevelt disposed of one of his isolationist enemies, Walt Disney, was when the foreign market in movies dried up because Germany wouldn't have American movies because he thought that they were all anti-Nazi. That wasn't true in the case of the animated features of Walt Disney, but never mind, he also got shut out. So Roosevelt provided him with federal money to go down and make some movies in order in South America in order to show that the United States was a benign neighbor and was going to look after their best interests. And if you're old enough, you may remember a movie called The Three Amigos, yeah, which had three parrots who sang. That was all. And then there was a wonderful Donald Duck movie about sailing on Lake Titicaca, where his straw boat unravels as he goes halfway across, and so on. So there are a whole batch of those. And then after that, Disney was continued to be bought off by endless, mostly Donald Duck, cartoons to be made for training freshmen into the army and so on how to get up early in the morning and how to do all the things necessary. So yeah, they were very anxious about South America, and that was another reason to draw the line down, so that actually the American Navy, which by the way, towards the late 30s, there wasn't much of it there. I mean, they had to build their own navy. We had to build our own navy, I should say. It was true of the army too. They were not equipped. I mean, it was a matter of they started producing things very fast thanks to Henry Ford's mass production techniques. But the big decision actually in Roosevelt's mind was: do you give all of this to Britain with the anxiety that it might just get lost? I mean, the Germans just might take it, or do you keep it in America and then just let Britain take its chances? And that was a close-run thing, actually.
There's a piece of Roosevelt's policy that suggests he was not serious for a long time about preparing for war, which is that when he began the military buildup for the United States, he focused entirely on ships and aircraft, which were the two weapons that he thought could keep the war away from the United States. They were deterrent weapons. He thought that no country would dare risk war with the United States because the United States could reach out. And even his approach to Japan, his approach to deterring Japan in the Pacific, is send all of our B-17s to the Philippines because the Japanese will be afraid of bombing raids on their home country. That policy suggests an ambivalence about whether or not the United States will actually be involved in the war until quite late, I think. And it's General Marshall, in particular, who tells him, you're crazy if you think that's the way to rebuild your military. You have to actually prepare a military for war and not just one you think can deter an enemy.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. But they were not equipped. I mean,
they
had a lot of horses. I mean, you know, they were like, we joke about the Poles sending horses in against tanks. But in the same period, the United States still, the Army still had a lot of
I think the statistic on September 1st, 1939, the day where the war begins, is the United States has, I believe, the 17th largest army in the world, yeah. sandwiched between those notable military powers, Portugal and Bulgaria, if I remember correctly.
Exactly. But still, if you start enlisting people, then, of course, you start alarming people. Okay. And that's what he couldn't do.
That's true. Let's go in the back over there, and then we'll come front.
The mic.
I'm going to buy your book, first of all. The gentleman mentioned South America, and we've been talking about Joe Kennedy quite a bit. Are you familiar with the first interaction that FDR had with Joe Kennedy when FDR was Assistant Secretary of the Navy?
With Joe Kennedy?
Yes.
Not when he was Assistant Secretary of the Navy. I didn't know that actually even Franklin Roosevelt knew Joe Kennedy in 1918. Please tell me.
Very few people knew it. And I read this. Okay. Essentially, the ambassador for Argentina came to FDR when he was Assistant Secretary of the Navy, and Daniels was on vacation. And as was FDR's practice, he basically acted as Secretary of the Navy.
Whether Daniels was there or not.
Correct. And the ambassador to Argentina expressed concern, okay, that the company that was building three cruisers for Argentina, okay, would not release the cruisers even though they were completed because Argentina did not have the funds to pay for it. So FDR called the president, I think it was Inland Steel, Bethlehem Steel, one of the big shipbuilding companies, okay, to plead to have the ships released.
You're right. It's in the book, by the way.
Oh, is it?
Okay. But carry on. It's a great story.
So the president of the steel company sent his general manager from the shipyard to meet with Kennedy, okay, to FDR. And the manager was Joe Kennedy, okay? And Joe Kennedy refused to release the ships. Okay? Are you familiar with the story?
Yeah. Yes.
Could you please
elaborate? It is in the book. I'm sorry.
You'll find it.
I'm sorry. I was caught. Anyway.
I think the audience would love to hear the story.
Kennedy was not really interested in running a shipyard, but he thought he ought to do something. And so he ran actually very efficiently. He was a very good manager. He ran the shipyard, but he did have trouble trying to get the money out of the Argentines, and they needed the ships, and they wouldn't provide the cash. And so he said, I'm going to hold the ships until you cough out the money. And the next thing you know, the Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Franklin Roosevelt, said, sent in the U.S. Navy in order to take the ships out of the port, and he had them over to Argentina, and that was the beginning of the humiliation of Joe Kennedy. It also led to him, by the way, Roosevelt appointing him the head of the Maritime Commission in the 30s. There was a link. He rewarded him in small measure. And very late on, even in World War II, when it had started, and Joe Kennedy, as always, kept volunteering for big jobs, and he was always ignored. He was offered one job, which was to effectively go back to running a single naval shipyard.
We have a question up here.
Good evening. My name is Paul Pendorf. My question has to do with the declaration of war against Japan after Pearl Harbor and the fact that Roosevelt didn't feel that he had the votes to declare war against Germany. The general belief is that Hitler made a massive blunder by letting the Japanese trick him into declaring war on America. But if he had not been so stupid, what was the backup strategy for Franklin Roosevelt to actually get into a Germany first strategy? They have to first have a declaration of war.
It's not at all clear because he didn't share all of his thoughts on this issue. You're quite right.
I'm unaware of any theories.
What happened in brief was that the Japanese and the Germans and the Italians had a mutual defense pact. And so when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor and the United States declared war on Japan, 3 days later, Hitler declared war on the United States, which saved Franklin Roosevelt a great deal of trouble.
But just to be clear, the Tripartite Pact did not require Germany to go to Japan's aid unless Japan had been attacked. And since Japan had launched the war, Hitler had an easy out. I mean, not that Hitler paid much attention to the agreements he signed anyway. So he certainly could have ignored it no matter what, but he chose not to.
But wasn't that the Japanese ambassador who spoke fluent German and was on excellent terms with Hitler basically tricked him with a bogus deal?
Yeah, it's true that the Japanese were still negotiating when Pearl Harbor was going on.
I mean, if you declare war on the United States because the Wehrmacht is stalled outside of Moscow, so things are not looking so hot now in the middle of December, in the Russian winter. So we're worried about the sleeping giant, and if you declare war on on Germany, that means that the Germans will have to transfer.
Absolutely. They already had a war on two fronts.
Yeah.
And they opened up a third front. But happily, Hitler wasn't a very good general, it turned out.
There's no hint in a historical record about Roosevelt mulling these.
No, as I say, I think actually, in a way, the Pearl Harbor, sure, it was a fundamental traumatic event. But actually, the United States had been at war with Germany for quite a while. And so that having, Japan having declared war, or the United States having declared war on Japan after Pearl Harbor, it was only a matter of something or other before it happened. I'd not got much anxiety somehow that the isolationists totally collapsed at Pearl Harbor. They wasn't.
Germany hadn't declared war on America, that this would have dragged on into 1942.
Well, it was December 41, so it probably would have gone into 42, but not very far into 42 is my guess. But this is all with hindsight. I mean, this is all trying to work out.
And it's not like the United States actually actively engaged significantly in the war against Germany in the early part of 1942 anyway.
Yeah.
The United States didn't have the means to do that.
Exactly.
But it's an interesting point here that Roosevelt was pushing in the second half of 1941, as you tell in the book, pushing to get Germany to engage in some kind of military action that would give the United States an excuse to go into the war. But he didn't want war in the Pacific at that point because the United States was so unready for it. And he hoped by putting the Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor and the B-17s in the Philippines to deter the Japanese long enough for the United States to be more ready. So he got the wrong war. And Hitler bailed him out in the short run by deciding to declare war. But I agree, it would have happened in a relatively short time anyway.
But Pearl Harbor was a genuine surprise. I mean, that's not what he was expecting. And the Japanese wasn't only Pearl Harbor. I mean, if you listen to the speech to Congress on the day after Pearl Harbor, the infamy speech,
right,
he lists all of the places that Japan simultaneously attacked. And they didn't expect any of that. But he'd already worked out with Churchill that strategically you have to take Europe before you take the Pacific. The Pacific was going to be a long haul, and literally a long haul. If you look at the spinning globe and freeze it when the Pacific's in the middle, it's all blue. I mean, it's a very long distance to go. It's a horrible war to manage. You'd think that getting over the Atlantic was bad enough, but there were stepping stones. There's Greenland and Iceland. There are ways to do it, but not in the Pacific. In any case, I think that Nazism was far more virulent a strain of fascism than the Japanese version.
We have time for one final question. Let me take this one over here. Could you just wait for the microphone? I'm sorry.
Good, we got a woman. That's a very good idea.
Thank you. Is there any politician today who remotely possesses FDR's combination of political skills?
This is a dinner party game, isn't it? It could last a couple of hours. I think the only person with the people skills is Bill Clinton, plainly. And also, you know, I mean, if you think of the last presidential election, the best speech was by Bill Clinton, you know, talking about the economy, saying it's arithmetic, it's simple, you know. I mean, and he can explain something. If you take the lend-lease, you know, lending the garden hose. I mean, everybody could understand exactly what he had in mind and why it would be morally wrong to sell the garden hose to your neighbor if he has a fire. So that ability Bill Clinton can do, plainly. In terms of, you know, strategic understanding, I'm not sure. And is there anyone left on either party that has that sense of noblesse oblige, you know? Roosevelt had a trust fund that made him, in today's money, $1.4 million a year for doing nothing. So he could do exactly as he liked. He could, like many rich people today, not do very much or fund global warming anti-science or something. But he actually chose to devote himself, notwithstanding the fact that he was severely physically disabled, so every movement was painful to him, into public service. I think we've sort of run out of that sort of patrician in the United States altogether, and I'm not sure where they're going to come from.
I will just say that we are also perhaps fortunate that we don't live under circumstances that require a Roosevelt right now.
Well, we had a terrible economic crash. So, anyway.
I want to thank our guest.
Thank you.